This is it. This is the last video of 2020 and it is 31st December 2020. In a few hours of this premiere, we are going to enter into the new year and this is it. This is it. This is the video where I really, really, really am thankful to 2020 in general. So for many people, basically 2020 has been not a good year, maybe because they've lost someone because of the pandemic, or they lost their living because of a pandemic, and you know, a lot of unfortunate things like that have happened this year. And for me, it's been a bittersweet year actually. I wouldn't say that 2020 should have never happened. 2020 should have happened no matter what, and I should have been a part of it. So let me just say, the bitter part of it was professionally. I think things were a bit icky, I would say. Like, I think icky is the strong word there. With respect to productivity and with respect to my work professionally as well, things did take a bit of a bitter turn. And I'm still working on that, those fronts of my life. But with respect to a lot of other things, my life has increased, like the quality of my life has increased like 10-20 fold. So basically, I decided to get back on YouTube in I think April-May 2020, where I was talking about the Asian Readathon, my TBR for the Asian Readathon. And when I saw the videos of the Asian Readathon first, I decided that I wanted to read you know, more of Asian literature, and that's why I wanted to get on with the whole thing. And that's how I ended up posting my first video in a very long time. And post that, things just like went, you know, it just raced forward, honestly, because soon I started realizing, so disclaimer, okay, now this is the thing. One of the reasons why I actually left BookTube, this is not something I normally discuss, and it's like whenever anyone in my life as well asks me why don't I film YouTube videos, unless and until they're very close to me, I just give them like a lame answer. But if they are close to me, I let them know that the truth, this is why I left YouTube, and this is what made me realize YouTube as a platform or social media in general was not like a healthy place. So I think like I can give you like examples. Like I had started realizing this before this incident, like before this example, but then later on I started realizing it even more because of the comments that I would get. So when I started my channel, I started it as an art channel because I wanted like an outlet for my art. And so basically, like if you know me, or if you want to know me, let me tell you that I dabble in three things. I love art, I love books, I love writing, and I also love productivity a lot. Now, when I say productivity, I don't believe in those harmful productivity stuff that people do. I love bullet journaling, I love things like that, but those are not the things that I speak in public about. Like, there was a time when I used to do that, but this channel for me is about books, and I talk about my art and my productivity on my Instagram. Because that's like a much better place to talk about these things, in my opinion, just for me. So yeah, let me just get to the story, because this is like story time. So when I posted my bullet journal video, because I realized that many people in India did not know what the bullet journal was, I posted it and I said, okay, you know, this is the Indian bullet journal. And one of the things that I realized was whenever I used to watch Americans, or, you know, write their bullet journal or draw their bullet journal, there were many items at that time, like washi tape, or, you know, all of these Tombow pens that people would use. All of these were not available in India at that time. Okay, they did come up to India later on, after ages, I would say after like a good 1.5 years, because there was a demand for it. But when I had posted it, washi tape was expensive AF. It is still expensive AF in India, by the way, and I know like a couple of stores only who sell good quality washi tape, although I've not tried out their washi tape yet. But that being said, you get the gist, right? So India, like that, was not a market for bullet journaling or stationery supplies for that matter, and it's only with the rise of social media that all of this had come in. And in that particular video, I received quite a few comments which stated that, watch other bullet journals, like watch BuzzFeed's bullet journals, watch this person's bullet journals, they are so beautiful, yours is a very shitty bullet journal. And I just realized, okay, cool. I mean, I was not discouraged by the comment because I had already started realizing that YouTube in general is a very real world. Like, now we know that because of social media, like reels versus reels, that kind of situation. So basically, from what I understood was that people on YouTube, like my impression then was most of the people who are famous on YouTube just do things for show. They don't show what goes behind the scenes. There was no, I would say, there was no genuine emotion to what they were doing. They were just doing it as a form of business, as a form of show business, and I did not appreciate that at all. And it did have a huge impact on me. The fact that this realization that people who are famous on YouTube are in the show business and they just do it for the likes, for the subscribers, for blah blah blah, and it really hurt me a lot. And that's when I realized the toxicity of YouTube in the first place. That being said, later on, when all of these comments started popping up on my bullet journal video, I even replied to some of them stating that, listen, dude, if you want to make a bullet journal like this, like please do that. But understand that in real life, especially like when you're in a country where you may not get access to these items necessarily, not even like basic washi tape that's used for bullet journaling, then I'm sorry, you can do it your way then. I was not that rude. I was pretty straightforward with the fact that, dude, this is how a bullet journal really looks. And this is how it really looks, okay? It's not supposed to look pretty, it's supposed to look you and not what others are doing. You can watch other people's videos for inspiration, but then understand the difference between real and real. And at that time when, so that was a time in India when Jio was still not there, okay? Jio was still in the making. This was a time when I used to upload on my BSNL MTNL Wi-Fi. And I still upload on my BSNL MTNL Wi-Fi, by the way. But this is a very Indian-centric thing. Like, that's what I'm trying to tell you, right? That early on in my YouTube journey, I realized that people do things just for show on YouTube. And most of the famous people, now I'm not going to be categorizing people anyway. I'm just telling you, YouTube is a show business. Instagram is a show business, okay? The only difference is that in this show business, it's you who has the power to show what goes on and what doesn't go on. And I genuinely didn't like that. Okay, I like people with integrity. I like people who are real in front of the camera or wherever it is, instead of people who just show a small aspect of their good life and the rest of their life is just like, which is the bad side. They just like don't want to talk about it. They just want to show the good on social media. And that affected me a lot. So generally, if I've stated this, when people who are very close to me or whom I'm comfortable with ask me, I do share this reason with them. But when people whom I don't know or who are strangers ask me when am I getting on YouTube, I tell them about work commitments. But this was a part of social media that affected me for a very long time. But things changed during the pandemic. This kind of prejudice that I had against social media. Now, I was not active personally on social media. I was still active on YouTube, not on this channel though. I was still active on my Instagram, although I have a very on and off relationship with my Instagram. And also, I used to have a Facebook profile as well, but I don't have that anymore because of a lot of negativity and toxicity that runs through social media. So, yeah, that being said, let's get to the pandemic, right? That's when I decided to put out my Asian Readathon TBR and tell people that yes, this is what I'm reading for my Asian Readathon. And I had a lot of thoughts, right? I had a lot of thoughts before it because I was doing it after such a long time. I was maybe not familiar with the BookTube part of it much. Like, I knew a lot of booktubers for that matter, and that's how I got to know about the Asian Readathon. But I was not sure, like, as a creator, what would be the new trends and stuff, so that was it. But then finally I decided that, okay, you know what, cool, let me just post it. I want to do it, I'm going to post it. And that's how I ended up posting my first Asian Readathon, TBR, okay? And then it just went uphill from there. And I'm so glad, touch wood, I'm very glad that things turned out the way it turned out to be. Because one, I made friends on BookTube. I've hosted readathons, I've attended group reads. I mean, I've hosted group reads, I've attended group reads. I've known a lot of people from all over the world only because I joined BookTube. And the next thing being, I got to know a lot of Indian booktubers as well who make lovely content, and I'm also like friends with them, you know. Basically we are just like buddies, like chatting and stuff like that, and that's just like super cool. And that being said, it also boils down to, like, I met a lot of people. I met Smriti, I met Ki, I met Charvi, Manya, the reading party people, like a lot of stuff has happened, right? Because as soon as I discovered someone, I would discover someone else, and then we would like connect like that. We would connect via Instagram, we would comment on YouTube by commenting on other people's videos, and finally it came down to Zoom calls, and then now we are just like friends all over and stuff like that. So my point being that if the pandemic would not have happened, I would not have posted the video, that's the Asian Readathon TBR video. If I would not have posted Asian Readathon TBR video, I would still be like a watcher of BookTube and not a creator on BookTube. And being a creator on BookTube, like, changed my reading life forever. Like, really. And again, you know, one of the realizations that I came to this year when I started making videos was this fact that although there's a lot of like show business thing that's going on YouTube and Instagram, and that's like real, you cannot change that because it's on a person what kind of content they want to put. I had decided that I don't want to like be a part of the show business. I'm not someone who does things for show. I do things out of genuine love for things. I do things out of my passion for things. Like, I paint because I love painting. I read because I love books. I love reading, and reading will always be my first love. I love being productive because I like being an organized person in general. So all of that being said, I decided that I don't effing care about the people who want to run YouTube as a show business. I am just here for my genuine love of books, for my genuine love of other things as well. And that's how we are here. That's how we are at 1k subscribers. Honestly, I was not even expecting 1k. I was like, okay, cool, I'll just get back and I'll be like, okay, making videos because I love making videos. And maybe a small part of me was happy that I got back and, you know, my subscriber count was increasing. But I did not want to have my you know, happiness placed there. Like, I didn't want to be like, oh, I'll be happy when I get 1k subs. Like, I didn't want to do that, because the moment you start doing that, like, it becomes a form of instant gratification, and then you just feel like, okay, so now I reached this goal, now I have to reach the next goal. And for me, it's never about the goals, especially with the things I love. I just do whatever I feel like, and I just like end up following my gut for that matter. And yeah, that's what that is, right? Because the point is, when you really love something in a very genuine manner, this is something that I realized, by the way, when you really love something in a very genuine manner, and you're very real and genuine about whatever you're doing, you're sincere about whatever you're doing, then ultimately you will get people who like your content, or you will get to know about people who appreciate watching your videos or whatever content you put out there. Like, this is true for every artist. Every artist, I'm not even kidding you. Like, if you are someone who's like an illustrator and you just put out work on social media, if people really like your work, they will gravitate towards it. And that's been my realization. And that's how it is. That's how it has always been with me. And that being said, it's just it's a very warm and fuzzy feeling like I say, like I've said this when I got my 1k subscribers like count, I was like, I was really shocked because I was not even tracking it. I mean, I knew that I would be reaching that milestone because I had crossed like 900 anyway in November, like in the last week of November or something. I was like, oh, cool, I've crossed 900, like let's just see. And I was expecting that maybe in 2021 I'll reach 1k or something and stuff like that. So the reason I'm talking about like this 1k thing is because it's like a pleasant surprise for me. Also, like a lot of people who start their YouTube channels want to just reach that number ASAP, but let me just tell you that it does not happen that way. Number one thing, you need to have that genuine love for whatever you're putting out. Number two thing, you need to be consistent, and I think consistency has helped a lot for me at least. And also the third thing being, don't come here because you wanted views or you wanted subscribers or you want to go viral. Like, come here because you love something and you want to show off to the world that yes, I love this and I think you should also do this. And that's how things work. So that's why 2020 has been a great year for me. I am just filled with gratitude for 2020, and it's just, I don't know, it's been a very beautiful year for me. Yes, like I said, it's bittersweet, but then I can tell you that the sweet part of it was like just delicious. Okay, I love sweets in general, but the sweet part of 2020 was just chef's kiss, and I can maybe like, you know, forget the bitter part because there were so many sweet things that happened to me this year. So thank you for being here, thank you. And if this has been a bad year for you, I'm very sorry about that. I'm hoping that 2021 becomes the year that you want it to be. And that being said, I love you guys. Thank you so much for being here. And thank you for watching this premiere. If you're watching this premiere, or if you're watching the video, thank you for watching the video. I'll see you in my video tomorrow. Before I go, wishing you all a very, very, very happy 2021. Have a great year ahead. And also, Enjoy your New Year's Eve. Even if you are at home, be grateful, enjoy, have a sip of wine maybe, just relax, put your foot on the couch. Lovely. Life is nice, life is good, and 2021 is going to be a good year. Okay, cool. Bye.